Hello, welcome to another video in our GoJS beginner video series. This video will explain how to specify templates for styling nodes, links, and groups in GoJS diagrams. Using GoJS requires programming in JavaScript and familiarity with HTML and CSS. You will benefit from previously viewing Building Parts with GoJS, Parts and Panels, which delivers an explanation of parts, panels, and graph objects. You will also benefit from viewing our video, The GoJS Diagram Model, which covers how simple data is stored to be visualized later by the diagram. Basic familiarity with these topics is assumed for this video. GoJS parts, nodes, links, groups, and adornments, are comprised of panels, which are comprised of various graph objects. You could add a part, say a node, directly to the diagram and specify all its styling at once, like this. But what would happen if you wanted to add another node with some different data but the same style? You'd have to specify the exact style you'd want by hand, like before. Thankfully, GoJS supports part templates. In this case, you would set the node template to a node that contains the style you want for all your nodes, ensure the diagram model's node data array contains data for these nodes, and then see that the two nodes are rendered in the diagram with the same style. How did GoJS know to use our node template to style both these nodes? The diagram model allows for separation between part data and part appearance. All model data objects support a data property called category. The value of this property corresponds with the template to use when GoJS determines this part's appearance. Not supplying this property, as we did earlier, makes the rendered part take on the style defined by its corresponding template, or the default styling for that part if no template is provided. For example, node data without a specified category renders using the value in node template map corresponding with the empty string key, which node template is a synonym for, or it will use the GoJS default node template. Alternatively, if a value for category is defined, that part will be styled according to the template corresponding with the part template mapped to the provided category value inside the appropriate part template map. GoJS supports node template map, group template map, and link template map. This is a powerful feature, as it allows for an arbitrary number of templates for styling your diagram's nodes, links, and groups. To define these part templates in their respective template maps, you must call templateMap.add, then pass the key to be used for the template, which is the value you pass to the category data property in the model, then pass the part itself to be used as a template. For instance, if we are going to define a template for square nodes, we might call NodeTemplateMap.add and pass the string square as the first parameter, then for the second parameter, construct the node we want to use as our template using go.graphobject.make. We've already seen how to define parts in our video, Building Parts, Parts and Panels, and we've seen how you can define whatever custom properties you want on node or link model data. However, simply defining a bunch of properties in model data will not do anything. You must tell your part how these properties will affect its appearance or behavior. To do this, GoJS provides something called data bindings. Data bindings are a powerful feature of GoJS that allow for arbitrary appearance and behavior changes of parts or their graph object elements conditional on the part's corresponding data object's data properties in the model. They allow for communication between part data and the visualized part itself. To create a data binding in the initialization of the graph object you want it to affect, pass a new go.binding. For a simple binding, pass the graph object property you want to bind as the first parameter, and the source data property as the second parameter. For example, if we want to bind the fill of a node's shape element to the color property in model data, we create a new go.binding in the shape constructor and pass fill as the first parameter, the target, and color as the second, the source. Ensure there is a color data property defined in the model, then load the page. We see the fill of the shape element of the node is the color defined in model data. If there was no color data property defined in model data, the fill of the node's shape would be whatever the default value is set in the shape definition. If no default fill property value is set, the fill property defaults to black. Data bindings can also be more complex, using something called a conversion function. A conversion function is a function that is passed as a third parameter to the binding constructor. The conversion function is passed the value of the model data property specified in the second binding constructor parameter. Inside the conversion function, some computation occurs, and whatever value is returned is used to set the graph object property the binding is affecting. As a simple example, we'll still bind shape fill to model data color, but this time, instead of strings, the color model data property will be a number, either 0 or 1. Inside our binding constructor, we'll add a third parameter, a function, to serve as our conversion function. The conversion function is passed the value of the color property in model data, which we'll refer to as C. Inside the conversion function, we'll check if C is 0 or 1. If it's 0, we'll return red, and if it's 1, we'll return blue. Ensure we have three nodes in our model. Two should have the color property set to 0 or 1. Set the last one's color data property to some random number, say 42. Load the page. We see the node with 0 as its color model data property has its shape filled in red. The one with 1 as its color model data property has its shape filled in blue. The conversion function doesn't know what to do with a color data property value of 42, so the fill of the shape of our last node is set to its default value, in this case, black. Let's explore how to define part templates now. There are some differences in the way we construct node, link, and group templates. Let's construct semi-complex example templates for each part type and go over some of those differences. First, we'll build a template for our nodes. Even though we're only going to build a single template for nodes, a single template for links, and a single template for groups in this video, we're still going to use template maps. Let's start with a call to mydiagram.nodeTemplateMap.add and pass it the key we want to associate with this node template as its first parameter. Let's call this node template SimpleNode. The next parameter is the node itself, which acts as a template for all nodes in the category SimpleNode. Let's make the panel type for the node Spot. If you need a refresher on what panel types are, watch the Building Parts, Parts and Panels video. Inside this node, we will have a shape that will act as the main element of the panel. This shape will be a rectangle, with its fill property set to white, and its desired size property set to a new go.size with a width of 100 and a height of 20. Add some node data to the model with its category data property set to simple node, and then take a look at what we have. It just appears as a rectangle now. Since that rectangle is the main element of the spot panel, the alignments for all following elements of this node will be relative to the boundaries of this rectangle. Let's go back and add two more elements to the node template. We'll add a panel and another shape. We'll get to the new panel in a moment, but for now, we'll define this last shape's figure to be triangle up and set some properties. Fill, which we'll set to white, desired size, which we'll set to a new go.size with height and width both 20, and the alignment property, which, since this element is inside a spot panel, will determine where this shape is positioned relative to our first shape, the rectangle. We'll set the alignment value to go.spot.right. Now, look at what we have. The triangle shape appears on the far right of the panel main element, the rectangle shape. Let's go back to the panel we added before the last shape. This is our first example of nesting panels. The node itself is a panel, a spot panel, as we've discussed, but panels may hold other panels as well, allowing for arbitrarily complex templates. We'll make this panel an auto panel. Ensure it appears on the left side of our rectangle shape by setting the panel's alignment property to go.spot.left. Then, give it two elements, a shape, which will act as the main element of the auto panel, and a text block. Since this is an auto panel, the main element, the shape, will stretch to accommodate all the other elements of this panel, in this case, just the text block. For the shape, let's make it an ellipse and define its fill property to white. For the text block, we'll just define its text to be simple node. Now look, the left aligned auto panel appears as an ellipse enclosing the text simple node. Let's define a group template. Just as with our node template, we'll add it to the group template map with a call to mydiagram.grouptemplateMap.add. We pass simple group as the first parameter and the group to use as the template for the second parameter. We'll start with just a plain group, constructed in the same way we construct a node. Groups are a subclass of node that allow for them to hold and organize an arbitrary number of nodes and links. As such, much of the process for defining a group template is analogous to defining a node template. We'll set a panel type for the group, just as we would a node. Let's set the panel type to vertical. This vertical panel will hold two elements, a text block and another panel. The text block acts as a title. Let's make it say group. The panel will be an auto panel, and it will hold the group's members. Its main element is a shape, which will be a rounded rectangle with its fill property set to beige. Its next element is a placeholder. A placeholder is a special kind of graph object that is used only with groups and adornments. If the group has a placeholder, the placeholder represents the area of all the member parts of the group. There can be at most one placeholder per group or adornment. Let's give this placeholder's padding property a value of 5, so there are 5 pixels of space around the group's members. Add some model data for this group. Add an element in the node data array with key beta, and the GoJS supported isGroup property set to true. Ensure its category is simple group, which will make it use the template we just defined. Add 2 more node data objects in the model, gamma and delta, and set their GoJS supported group data property to beta, the key of our group. Let's look at what we have. Since we put the placeholder inside the auto panel, that panel, whose main element is the beige shape, is adjusted to fit all the members of the group. Notice how there are always 5 pixels between the group's members and the edge of the shape. That is because we set the placeholder's padding property to 5. Let's define a link template. The first element of a link is a shape. This is the path that users see connecting two nodes. The root of the link is a list of points that is computed automatically by GoJS, depending on the properties of the link and of the connected nodes, including their locations. Just as before, we'll add this template to the link template map with a call to mydiagram.linktemplatemap.add. We'll pass simple link as the first parameter, and the link to use as the template for the second parameter. This link will have 3 elements, 2 shapes and a text block. The first shape we'll leave alone. As mentioned, this shape represents the shaft of the link itself, whose geometry is computed dynamically by GoJS. The second shape will be an arrowhead. We'll make it appear as an arrowhead pointing to the node defined by a link of this category's to data property. We'll accomplish this by setting the to arrow property of the shape to standard. The text block will act as a label for the link. We'll set its default text to link. By default, this text block will appear in the center of the link. Let's make it appear just a bit below the link by setting its segment offset property to a new go.point value, with an x value of 0 and a y value of 10. This will make the text block display where it normally would horizontally, half the length of the link, but 10 pixels below where it normally would have been. Add the link data array parameter to the model. Give it one link data object that connects our alpha node to our beta node, and ensure its category is set to simple link. Now, let's see what we have. The link appears, connecting two nodes. This connection is the first shape of our template. The arrowhead pointing to the to node is the second shape of our template. And the text that appears halfway across and a little below the link is our text block, whose precise positioning was determined by the segment offset value we provided. Notice how if we move our alpha node, the node not in the group, we see the link stays in contact with the group, not one of the group's member nodes. Since groups are subclasses of node, they are treated as their own entity when connecting links to or from them. Let's see how data bindings allow for us to bind graph object properties, the preset GoJS properties of parts and their elements themselves, to the properties we define at will in the data. We'll manipulate our node template to exemplify this. Let's add a data binding to the text block element of the auto panel. We'll bind the text property of the text block to the key data property in the model. To do this, we create a new go.binding inside the text block constructor and pass text and key as parameters, respectively. Now, look at what we have. The text inside the panel on the left of any node of category simple node is bound to the value of its key data property. We can define more complex data bindings by use of conversion functions. Let's bind the fill property of the shape element in the auto panel to a data property called color. In our node data array, ensure there are 2 nodes with the color data property set. However, instead of specifying a GoJS supported string color and data, we will specify a number, either 0 or 1. Then, when we build our data binding, for parameters we pass fill, color, and a function, respectively. This function is the conversion function. It will receive the value of the color data property as its parameter. Inside the function, we return a CSS color string based on the number. If it's 0, we return lime. If it's 1, we return cyan. Load the page. We see the node whose data has color set to 0 has a lime-filled shape, and the other has a cyan-filled shape. That's it for this video. To learn more about using part templates, visit the intro page on GoJS.net called Template Maps. The next recommended video is GoJS Graph Object Properties, which goes into detail about many of the different properties you can specify for the different kinds of graph objects in GoJS. Head over to GoJS.net to see hundreds of samples, read more about GoJS features on the intro pages, or peruse the full API documentation. Sign up for an unlimited free trial, and you'll get 30 days of developer-to-developer support for free.